Well, bless you all this morning, saints. Who's that desires that this morning, to have a close look with the Lord? It's my desire too. It just doesn't come the way that I think it is. Usually it comes in the way of a trial or something like that, and you find yourself in definite need of the Lord. It's a bit different when it's all going smoothly, you know. We tend to get a little bit sleepy and lazy and things like that. But the Lord knows how to deal with us. And I was just thinking as that you guys were singing that song, Never Alone, you know, so who told you that? Who told you? Who said, I'll never leave you alone? And he said it in his word, you know. And if you're a believer, that's for you. And everything that he said in there, you know, I think many times we can battle in all sorts of situations in this life. We're not immune to it. But if we can just look into his word and know that it's for you, what he said and what he's promised unto you. So we just thank the Lord that he said he'd never leave us alone. And we believe it. We'll just sing that song. I didn't have it down, but it's really just wonderful to know that he's, whatever happens, he's never going to leave us alone. I've seen the lightning flashing and heard the thunder roar. I've failed since break is passing, trying to conquer. I heard the voice of my Savior telling me still to fight on. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. All the choruses, sorry, all the verses and things like that, all personal. He promised he would never leave me alone. I'll just ask if Brother Paul would like to come and open in prayer, if you don't mind.
Oh, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that Lord, we can come and gather here, Lord. Amen. That your presence, Lord, will be felt in this auditorium, Lord. That you will touch us, that we'll feel your strength, and as that song said, you will never leave us alone, Lord. We thank you for your presence in our lives. We give you praise. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for bringing Sister Merle home to us today, this week, Lord. We welcome her back. We praise your name. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Paul. Welcome, Sister Mel, our Canadian resident. I thought you were never going to come back. No, but here you are. It's good to see you. Good to have you back. And Lord bless our visitors. I think it's Sharon as well. You've been here a few times. And also our other brother there. Lord bless you. May the Lord be your portion this morning. It's got nothing to do with us and everything to do with him. And that's what we want. Shall we sing number 337? How lovely on the mountains.
How lovely are the mountains, are the feet of him who bring good news, good news. Proclaiming peace, announcing news of happy news. How God reigns. Amen.
reign in your life if you let him. If you let him. Is there any, was there going to be any items this morning? One from Sister Pauline? Okay, thank you, just so I can time it right. Let's sing number 331, When I See the Blood.
Christ our Redeemer died on the cross, died for the sinner, paid all his debt, sprinkled our soul with the blood of the Lamb, and thou will pass on the shore.
Let's just sing number 174, Praise Him, Praise Him.
Him, praise Him, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him when the sun. Worship, worship,
Sunday. We don't want to just praise Him and worship Him on Sunday. He just wants to hear from you any day of the week. He's listening, just listening for you to see what you got to say. See, listening number 271, and then I'll ask Sister Pauline to bring her item.
Burdens now are lighter, brighter is my way. It is such a joy to walk with Him. When this journey hits, and its joy will soon begin. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. Praise the Lord, today I know I'm free. He is with me, and if I stay,
Sister Pauline. And just a few notices, we'll have afternoon service at 1 o'clock and lunch, and also Tuesday prayer meeting at 7 o'clock.
Would appear before God to give me something I would know about, so the truth would make me happy and the light would clearly shine, and the Spirit gave assurance.
Find out that's very relevant for this morning's message. It's not because somebody told you so, it's because there's a witness in your heart that says so, and nobody can take that away from you. If the Lord give it to you, nobody can take it away. I'm just going to ask if Brother Bill would like to bring these prayer requests. I'm not even going to read them out. I'll let him do that. I don't want to stumble through it. If you don't mind, Brother Bill, would you like to bring these prayer requests? Thank you.
Okay. I don't know why the Lord gave me this scripture, but it might be for someone here today. I've got a couple, actually. In Romans 8, verse 1, there is now therefore now no condemnation to those who which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. You know, so there's no condemnation. If there's anyone feeling condemned today, there's no condemnation. Hallelujah. That's what I just... felt in my seat. Just one of the songs. I just thought, one of the earlier songs. It says in Psalm 74:2, remember thy congregation which thou hast purchased of old, the rod of thine inheritance which thou hast redeemed, this Mount Zion wherein thou hast dwelt. You know, the purchasing of our salvation is of old. You know, even before the foundation of the world, he knew us. Amen. Eh? cool, eh, Huki? That even before we realised that God had already done, it was a finished work. And just thank you. Just so many needs. Josh rang up yesterday and he was saying, Dad, there's just so many real needs amongst people. And, you know, there's some needs here. Just wonder if anyone else has got any other needs. Jen's brother, Niall, he's a diabetic and got a really bad leg at the moment. And he's been in and out of hospital quite regularly recently, so I just want to lift him up. And some of you might know our Tongan policeman, his little daughter, Gloria. I don't know if you've met her. She's quite a sickly child, a bit hoa, and she had an abscess on her lung. And she had been away for 2 weeks overseas, came back, taken to the hospital up the coast, brought down here to Gisborne, and then way up to Auckland, and she's still in Auckland in Starship. There's nothing to her anyway. But she's got this abscess on her lung. And then what else, honey? She was vomiting up her feeding tube. And then she had to have a blood transfusion. She's just a tiny little thing, you know. Just lift her up before the Lord. Anyone else?
Anita,
her mum, who's got a really bad back after having to minister to her daughter up there in hospital. Anyone else? Tatu. A dialysis machine. And Tom's knee. Oh, niece. I thought it was your knee, bro. I thought you were looking all right standing up there this morning. Bronwyn. Kapoi. Anyone else? Sharon, who's your mate there?
Oh, this is my husband,
Sunny. Kia ora, Sunny. Nice to see you, bro. Anyone else? Mari? That's us then. Nice to see you, Mill.
Thank you.
Amen. So, Lord, we just want to bring these prayer requests before you, Lord Bronwyn, who needs a machine, a dialysis, Lord. And, Lord, just undertake for her at this time that you'll just be a peace in her heart, Lord Jesus. And that, Lord, that nothing can separate her from the love of God. So just pray for that right now, Lord, that she'll just be at peace as she goes on to this machine, Lord. And Lord, that you would just take care of everything that needs to be taken care of, even the financial needs, Lord. Sometimes that's huge just to get to Waikato and just whānau things. Just pray that you'd undertake for her. Lord Jesus, just for these prayers before me too, Lord. This lady Marjorie, she's suffering with extreme fear. She's lost her job and can hardly function, Lord. Just pray for Marjorie, Lord, the peace that passes all understanding, that perfect love casts out all fear, Lord. Just undertake that for Marjorie, Lord. Please keep Amy and her friend Kelsey in prayer today. Amy agreed to meet her, Kelsey, at a special worship, service at church tonight for people operating in gifts. Just pray that nothing would stop them from coming and that their hearts would be softened and be ready to receive from all that the Lord has done, and that they're touched in a personal way, Lord Jesus. Lord, just pray for Angie Brown, that you, Lord God, would deliver her from her enemies. We know that that's in your word, Lord, and bullies, and that you would just surround her with Christian friend. Lord, just pray for Tanya, who's suffering from an unwell husband, Lord. Just pray that you would just keep her through this trial, Lord, she and her husband. For Judy Moore, Lord, who's got a broken wrist, just pray for a speedy recovery for her. Yeah, we just thank you for the gift of prayer, Lord, and just uphold those people in India, Lord Jesus, Pastor Moses, that God would just press, that you, Lord God, you would just press through and just meet the needs of those people in India. We do pray for Israel, your anointed one, Lord. And just pray for the peace of Jerusalem and help them, Lord, in all their decision-making. And we bless Israel this morning, Lord. It says, they that bless Israel will be blessed. We bless Israel, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for our answered prayer requests, Lord. We are so grateful to you, Lord, that, even getting from Tomaru Bay to here is nothing short of a miracle these days. So many mad people out on the roads, Lord. Just thank you for Junie's mercies, Lord. And thank you for bringing our precious sister Merle back to us, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Can't see Sister Anna Guanano here today, Lord. Just meet her at her time, Lord, at home there, Lord, where someone might have it on their heart just to contact her and just to see if she's all right and got any needs, Lord. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Just want to share a real cool thing was I was brought up a Catholic and I knew all about, we knew about God, but never really knew God. And we went to a 60th birthday last night in Whareponga, and the boy whose 60th birthday it was, we were all brought up in the Catholic Church, all the Hugheses on one side and all the Heaneys on one side. But this family, the Tibble family, moved back to Ruatoria, and their mother, Olive, she's from down Fielding Way. She just loved the Lord, you know. She was full of the things of the Lord, this old Catholic. Well, she wasn't that old, but. And after church, after Mass every Sunday, we used to think it was a joke, but now I realise it wasn't funny at all, that it was a very precious time. But Auntie Olive would come, and she would grab us children and just put her hands on our head and said, "Bless you." And honestly, man, you know, you could feel I was saying to these fellas last night up in Ruatoria, you could feel the blessing of the Lord come down through this woman as she put her hands on you and said, "Bless you." We didn't know that you know, that kind of thing. She was a woman full of the Spirit of God. And I thought, how God is just sovereign, you know. I'm grateful, even though I don't follow being a Catholic anymore, that those seeds were planted right back then. Thank the Lord for that. Anyway, bless you, Timmy.
Thank you, Bill. We'll just sing a few more, and then I'll ask Brother Howard to come. Let's sing number 322. Three, two, two.
To love him, for he is mine. I love him, for he is divine. I've loved him forever, it seems. This Jesus, the Nazarene, I wonder just where I'd be if not for thank you. is here.
Praise the Lord. Who loves the Lord?
Amen.
You know, I'm just thinking about making mistakes on the piano. Of course, most of you wouldn't realise that there's a mistake happened, but we're in the wrong key to start with, right? Whenever that happens, I think, Lord, not going to be like that in heaven. It's going to be perfect. So I always take courage. If we make a mistake, when we get to glory, it'll be perfect. Won't be singing out of tune or none of that. It'll just be a perfect, wonderful fellowship of the Lord. Who loves the Lord?
Amen.
Praise be to God. So we just thank Him for His goodness and grace to us today. We welcome you all here in the name of the Lord and some of the visitors. God bless you as well. And this is just the last section of the study we're doing on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And this one is quite an important one to a lot of people, and a lot of people out there I know would be very interested. How do we know we have the baptism of the Holy Ghost? And that is so essential, because as we've gone through the... Oh, hi, Sister Merle, I'm just saying hi to you officially. I said hello before, but it's great to have you back. Not the same without Sister Merle and Sister Shirley. We need them both, don't we? I hope you get up singing one of these days. But anyway, it's a very important question. How do we know we have the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Because as we've said in the previous sessions, it's not something it'd be good to have. You need it. Otherwise, you will not be a part of that rapture. To be raptured, taken up to meet the Lord in the air, you have to be filled with the Holy Ghost. This is rapture season. This is the season in which God will come and take His people. We know by Scripture, by prophecy of the Bible, we're in the last days. We're living in the times of Sodom and Gomorrah. And so we know the vindication of God's Word has been before us. So we all need to be filled with the Holy Ghost and to receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and to accept the blood of Christ and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And we want to know today, how do we know we have the Holy Spirit? And I get that asked lots of times. And I'm just so glad that people do ask it, because I do believe they are believers. And because it's important to them, and it is, it's important to know that we know. And that He is living in us, that God is actually living in our bodies. He actually can live in here. He's a spirit, and He can live in you, abiding in Him, dwelling in us. And we're not just speaking about having a little anointing now and again, and that's good, those things are wonderful, or some sensation or some feeling, although those things do come with it, but that is no evidence that you have the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit of God dwelling in you. And but we want to be speaking about the true experience of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It's something we need. We must have it. And I was just talking, I think I mentioned it last week, I'll mention it again. When Brother Branham's first wife, Hope, was dying, She had meningitis. She had been in the flood in Jeffersonville, and the place was so flooded, up to two-story buildings were flooded, and he was out in his little motorboat trying to save people with other people, rescuers. So he couldn't get back to the hospital to see how his wife and daughter and son were doing. Anyway, when he got there, his wife had just passed away, and he was really upset. He got down on his knees at her bedside and said, "Lord Jesus, please bring her back so I can say goodbye to her." While he was speaking, she opened her eyes. And she said, "Bill, why did you bring me back? Why did you bring me back?" She says, "Glorious over there. It's wonderful to be in the presence of the Lord." And after she said that, very emotional time, I can assure you. If it's your wife or your husband, she said this to him, "Bill, you know how you've been preaching on the baptism of the Holy Ghost? Never, ever stop preaching it. Because it's so real on the other side. It's so important." So I don't apologize. I think we should be preaching it more and more, that people will receive the Holy Ghost. When Jesus comes, they'll go to meet him. Amen. Hallelujah. So may God bless that to us today. I just thought that was such a blessing, such an encouragement to me to hear him say that. Now the Bible, did we read the scripture? No. I got into the introduction and I just went on there. But let's just read our reading in Romans chapter 8 verse 14. Shall we just stand to read? I was going to reference back to you and I thought, where is that scripture reading? Okay. Must be getting old. Romans 8 verse 14 says, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." Now that's a wonderful thing in itself. "For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear." There's no fear in God. You know that if there's fear, it's not God, it's the devil. "But ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." Abba means Father. Father, Father. "The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God." The Holy Spirit bears witness with your spirit, telling you that you are a child of God. Amen. Glory! Isn't it wonderful? I want to know that I know that I'm a child of God. Praise the Lord. So that's what we want to be speaking about today. And the scripture does clearly state that scripture and others which we'll go through will tell you that you can know. It's not, "Oh, can I? I wonder if. Could it be?" No, you will know. You may be seated. Let's just pray. Lord Jesus, we pray that you'll quicken the truth of thy precious word to us. How we love thee, Lord. How precious you are to us. How good it is that you correct us. As our brother said this morning, we need your correction because we want to get closer to God. We know time's running out and people are drifting. But Lord, we pray that the Holy Spirit will correct us and show us how to get closer to you. In Jesus' name we ask it, Lord, for your glory. Amen. And so we see here, the Bible clearly states that we will know. We just read that in Romans 8:16, that his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are the sons of God. And it's not with our minds of reasoning that you know you're filled with the Holy Spirit. It's not with that. But it's with our hearts that Jesus Christ is living in us. You know that. Let's turn to John 14, verse 18. And Jesus said this, "I will not leave this, no, never alone, no, never alone." He promised never to leave me. Never to leave me alone. He said, "I'll not leave you comfortless." Jesus said, "I will come to you. Yet a little while and the world seeth me no more. But ye see me. Because I live, ye shall live also." Now listen to verse 20. At that day, there is an actual day when this happens. At that day, you shall know, not wonder, you shall know that I am in the Father, and ye in me, and I in you. Isn't that clear? He said, you will know that I'm in you, and you are in me. Talk about integration. God in us, and we in him. We are one. He's our Father, and we are his children. So the Holy Ghost is not a teaching. It's an experience. It's something you actually know. And when you walk out of church, you still know he's there. When you go to work, he's still with you. When you go at home, he's still with you. You know that he is with you. Praise the Lord. I'm glad it's that way. When I'm saying, oh, I better go down to the church to get the priest to pray for me and get filled up again. No, no. He's with you. Always. I'll never leave you. So I praise the Lord for that. You shall know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. You shall know it. So when he comes in, Brother Tom, you know it. Isn't that right? You know he's there. Hallelujah. You got the communication going. The lines, there's a telephone to heaven. There's a line going up there, and you can communicate with God. But he's in you. You cannot be separated. Thank you, Lord. So a Holy Ghost-filled believer knows that Jesus Christ is their Father. He's our Father. Isn't that wonderful, Tato? He's our Father, brother. Hallelujah. Let's turn to Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. It says this, but when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, so this was Mary, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that's us, that we might receive the adoption of sons. There we go into that whole wonderful story, but we haven't got time. And because ye are sons, because ye are sons, this is important, Brother Pessa, because you are a son, God has sent forth his Spirit of his Son into your heart, crying, Father, Father. He gives you the Holy Ghost because you are a son. And he's promised, Brother Bill, that he's going to be in you. He'll come and be in you. Why? Because you're his son. And he's not going to lose you. And he sends the Holy Ghost to keep you, to preserve you, as we said in the earlier services, and to sustain you, and to comfort you, and to fill you with the joy of the Lord. Who wants the joy of the Lord? Just get the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You'll have all the joy you could ever handle. So this is a very important subject. I cannot overemphasize this. How do we know we have the baptism of the Holy Ghost? So he is our Father. So we're reading here to redeem them. Because ye are sons, he has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your heart's crying, Abba, Father. That's a relationship thing. Father, Father. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. You possess everything God has got for you this morning. Hallelujah. It's yours this morning because you're a son or a daughter of God, and you become heir of God. Heir of God through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Praise be to God. So the Holy Ghost baptism gives you a sense of sonship. When the Spirit comes into you, you feel you're a part of God. You feel you're a son, and he's your Father. It's not, you don't learn this, it's an experience. You feel it, you know it. He said, you'll know. An assurance that he is your Father. This is a very important identification that you know. Because if you get on yourself, on your lonesome somewhere, you're out and there's no church around, there's no people around, There's no music around. There's no church around. And you're on your own. You've got to know that you belong to God. He's always there. He's ever ready. My child, I want you to do this. That's what I want. That's what I have, but I want more of it. Praise the Lord. So wonderful to have this. So may God bless us as we consider these things. No more a servant, but a son. He gives that sonship, that sense that you are a child of God. You're not a child of God because you come to this church. You're not a child of God because you go to the Catholic Church, Brother Bill. I believe what you said. That lady had something. I believe the Spirit of the Lord was in her. God's got his children everywhere. It's not what church you go to. It's who your father is and whether he lives in you. That's all that matters. Hallelujah. He's living in us. And you know, it's important identification. You know naturally who your father is. You just know. You know who your father is. You don't have somebody to tell you this. Now, you realize this is your father. I know that. And the same thing is in the spiritual. When God comes into you, you know that he is your father and that you belong to him. Now, it's important I say this. It's possible for you in your mind momentarily to doubt it. Because your mind is always questioning. If you do something wrong, you make a mistake, the devil will come along and accuse you. And say, you can't be a child of God. If you're a child of God, you would have never failed. He's lying to you. Now listen carefully. I'll tell you why. Because Satan has a job to do. And his job is to accuse you. Who believes that? Amen. Why do you believe it? Because it's in the Bible. Let's turn to Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. Satan's job is to bring up all your failures before the Lord. That is his job. His job is to bring up all your failures, Peter, before the Lord. That's what he does. He's employed. That's why he employs himself to do that. I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser, there is an accuser of the brethren. That's the believers. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, that's Satan, which accused them, that's you and I, before God day and night, is continually accusing us before the Heavenly Father. So every time, excuse me, every time you get that, failed. Oh, I can't. Am I a child of God? Am I not? Do I have the Holy Spirit? Do I not? When you get that feeling, that's Satan accusing you before the Father. And you feel that. But deep down on the believer's heart, it's blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. You know, when you get that accusation that you are not a believer or you have failed and you can't be it or you haven't got the goods, just say, blessed assurance. Sing it out. When you sing it out, it does something for you. It creates faith in your heart because it's the truth. We have a blessed assurance that Jesus is mine. Hallelujah. So the true believer knows that he knows that he knows. And what God has started in your life, he's going to finish it. God's not a rough workmanship. When he starts a job, he finishes it. And we're going to read that in Philippians 1:6. Being confident of this one thing, that he, that's God, which hath begun a good work in you, will perform it or complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. That's when he comes. So that's really wonderful. Has God started a work in you?
Amen.
What about you, Sister Mara? You didn't say amen. You did. You're looking at that kid. Okay. All right. He has started a work in you, sister. He's going to finish it. Hallelujah. Let's say praise the Lord. He which hath, it says there, being confident. You need to have the confidence. It's not you. It's God doing this. It's the work of the Holy Spirit that's working in you, started a work in you. He's going to finish it. God, there's another beautiful scripture in Psalm 138, verse 8. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hands. This is the workings of God. When he starts a work in you, he will perfect that which concerneth you. Isn't that wonderful, sister? It is so wonderful, isn't it? This is the working of the Holy Spirit. Now, I get asked this question many times. And I used to think about it, and I used to... Because, you know, when you travel a lot, and you meet a lot of people, and they fire this question at you every time, I said, Lord, I need to have a good answer for this. I know what they're trying to say. I sort of know the answer, but I want to put in words that they would be able to understand. And the question is there an evidence that you have the baptism of the Holy Ghost? What is the evidence? People like things tangible. This is a microphone. I can feel it. And when it comes to a question, people want to be able to handle it and want to know that there is an evidence. It's a bit like faith. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. It's an evidence. It's a guarantee. You have it. And it's not tangible, but it's an evidence. If faith is the evidence of things not seen. It's a guarantee of things hoped for. It's a hope we have, but it's real. What is the evidence that I have the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Now, I just want to say it like this. I'm going to say it how God showed me. There are many evidences. There's not just one. There are many evidences, but there's no single evidence by itself except the personal witness that you have inside you. That's it. He is the evidence. When he comes into you, you know. That's your evidence. You know. No man can say, oh, he has the Holy Spirit, or she has it, or he doesn't, or... You cannot do that. This is a personal thing. When you meet God, you know that you've met Almighty God. You don't need somebody to come along and prop you up. You know him because you met him. When I was a kid, I was only 14 years of age, and the Holy Spirit came to me. I tell you before God, who is my witness, you strike me dead. I know that I met him that Sunday evening in my mother and father's lounge room when they prayed for us. I knew I met God. He walked into the room and I met him. No one has to convince me of that. I know I met him. What a Savior. What a precious Lord he is. So loving and so merciful. And I felt so unworthy. I said, Lord, I'm just so unworthy. But the more I said I was unworthy, the more he loved me. His love excelled my unworthiness. And I thank him for his mercy and grace to me. So you see, there's... People judge the outside of people. They see, they're looking for evidences. Oh, he's not going to church every Sunday, or this one's not paying the tithes, or what? Yeah, all sorts of things. Or they're a bit worldly. Or listen, it's nothing to do with outside evidences. It's not the outward appearance, but God is looking at the heart. You know, a really precious thought you said about that lady, that Catholic lady. Well, she's a Catholic. It's nothing to do with being a Catholic. It's actually loving the Lord Jesus. You know, we know the Catholics maybe don't have everything right. We know they don't have everything right. They have Mary, we have Christ. He is our Savior. There's only one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. So we see that, but in their heart, I believe this with all my heart and soul. There'll be many Catholics in glory. They were burnt to the stake. Thousands, millions of Catholics were burnt to the stake when the Protestants took power in Europe. I'm telling you the truth. You read your history. And those people loved the Lord. They may not have had everything right. They may not have realized they just lived by faith, but they loved the Lord Jesus. And they trusted in God. And they will be there. The same with the Protestants. If they've met the Lord, they will be there. And He knows their hearts. There's so many stories we could tell, many testimonies. Time does not permit. But proof that God comes to the individual and you know God by a born-again experience. Hallelujah. I'm so glad He accepts us upon His grace and mercy. Some people may look at a ministry and say, oh, he must have the Holy Spirit. He preaches or whatever. Because the person that has an outstanding, kind and sweet nature, they must say, oh, he must have the Holy Spirit because he's sweet and kind. When people see someone operating the gift of the Spirit, they might be speaking in tongues, they might be prophesying. They say, oh, he must have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. In all of these cases, they may have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, but they may not. Now, that's Bible. So we don't want to go off signs, off impressions, off on evidences, which we call evidences. No, brothers and sisters, we cannot do that. We've got to go off what God's Word says. And Jesus gave some very clear examples of this very fact. We find this in Matthew 7, verse 21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And they did. And then I will profess unto them, I never knew you, Jesus said, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. So we cannot judge by the gifts we have. We cannot judge by the way God can even use people. He used Pharaoh of Egypt. The Bible says, I have raised up Pharaoh to reveal my glory. God said, I've raised up Pharaoh to reveal my glory. And he did. But he wasn't of God. But God used him just the same. God can do what he likes. Who believes God can do what he likes? You see, brothers and sisters, so we can't judge on what we see, what we feel, impressions we get. We're talking about receiving the Heavenly Father into our life. And just do what he says and believe what he says. There's no question these people were used with the gifts. There's so many people in the Pentecostal realms. I'm talking about the Pentecostal organizations today. Get so carried away with all the gifts and, oh, this must be of God. It may be, it may not be. Some of it is, some of it isn't. But they never receive, they're never filled with the Spirit. I'll tell you why. They're anointed ones at the end time. The Bible says there'll be anointed ones at the end time. They are anointed of the Spirit of God, but in their heart they're not committed to God. They're not actually given over to God. The Lord wants all of you, brother and sister. He doesn't want 99% of you. He wants 100% of you. And that puts you into a new bracket of being a bride member of Christ. When you are 100% given over to God, He fills you with His Spirit, then you are His sealed child of God. Now the Bible says in Matthew 5:45, talking about anointed ones. He says that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. Sister, I didn't give you the verse, did I? I'm sorry. Matthew 5:45. Ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he, that's God, maketh his sun, his blessing, to rise on the evil and on the good. He sendeth rain, the anointing, on the just and the unjust. That's the Bible. So anointings, is this a big subject? It's really hard to skim over it. But people get carried away with anointings because they're anointed. They are definitely a child of God. Well, they may be, but they may not be. Because he said the rain falls on the just and the unjust. Now, when the rain comes over Gisborne and it starts raining in the whole district, there could be a whole paddock of thistles, and the thistles are getting the water, and they are saying, praise the Lord, they're getting the blessings of God. Just like the wheat on the next paddock. It's in the next paddock. The wheat is saying, praise the Lord too. The same rain falls on the just and the unjust. And that's how it is in the spiritual realm. Jesus Christ said so. If you want to argue with that, you go and see him. But that's what he said. So maybe we come to the point, the evidence is, if we have a great revelation of the scriptures, may we can understand all the mysteries of the kingdom of God, all that God has revealed in this day. If we understand that, maybe then that's an evidence we have the Holy Ghost. It's a evidence, but it's not the evidence. There's a difference between a and the. School teachers, big difference. Between a evidence and the evidence, totally different meaning. Great, isn't it? How God has arranged that. So if they think, well, I've got a great revelation, let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 and 2. This is Bible. This is not Howard Searle. This is Bible. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels. So if you have an angelic tongue from the Holy Spirit, and have not charity, that's love, I become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal, shallowness. And though I have the gift of prophecy, you can prophesy, and understand all mysteries, not some of them, all mysteries, and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains and have not charity, have not love, which is God himself, the Holy Spirit, I am nothing. That is really a revelation, if there ever is. And it's not for me to judge anybody, but that's what he said. See, God is love. It's not God loves. It's more than God loves. He is love. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 16, for we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. There's your Holy Spirit. If you've got the true love of God, it's the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is love, God's love. It dwells in you. Dwelleth in love, dwelleth in God, and God in him. So there it is. It's all through the scriptures. So we don't want any false things in the church. We don't want any false things in our life. We want it to be genuine, pure, clean. Not just a little sensation or feeling or impression. It's got to be real, and you'll know it's God. And you know you're his child. And you know he's your heavenly Father. Hallelujah. Who's glad to be a child of God? And he will complete the work. He started in you, and he's going to finish the work. So we also have love for our brothers and sisters is another evidence, not the evidence, but it's another evidence. If we have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, is to have a love one for another. Jesus said in John 13, verse 35, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples when you have the revelation of the seven seals. Doesn't say that. When you have a great revelation of the Word of God, doesn't say that. This is how all men out there will know that you are a child of God, that you are a disciple of the Lord, is when you have love one to another. Why? Because He is love. And if He's in you, you can't help loving one another. Who loves one another? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's so wonderful, isn't it? It's pure. It's a pure word. Some believe love and the fruits of the Spirit is an evidence. No, it's not. It's a evidence. It doesn't mean it is the evidence. There's a big difference. But there are different types of love too. It's a major subject, but I'm just skimming the top. Human love is one thing, and it can be pretty nice. Be really nice to people, and you meet people that are always kind and sweet and always helpful. Man, I'd like to be like that person, and they don't even know the Lord. It's a human love. And there's a godly love too. That can be in people come to church that are really nice, and you know, like the kind old priest, he's kind to everybody, he looks really good. But it doesn't always turn out to be as it ought to be. I want to read you something. Brother Branham made a statement. He said, is there any here that hasn't received the baptism of the Holy Ghost? Yet. Now you say, Brother Branham, I tell you, I shouted one time. That's very good, he says. I spoke in tongues once. He said, that's very good too. But still, that isn't what I'm talking about. Now you can shout and speak in tongues. He says, now is a question actually. Now can you shout and speak in tongues and deny the Word of God? No. The evidence of the Holy Ghost is believing His word, always been, every age, if you can receive the word. He said those priests back in his day had Jesus beat a million times when it came to the fruits of the Spirit. They were gentle, they were peaceful, meek and lowly, he said. And he tore up the churches and he kicked them over and tore the people out. Called them snakes in the grass. So if you want to measure the outward manifestations, it looked like the priests were really sweet going around, you know. Can I help you? And Jesus was plaiting ropes and beating the money changers, kicking over their tables. You've made my house a den of thieves. Didn't look like it. And he had the spirit, and the high priest looked like they had the love. And maybe he didn't because of outward manifestations. But we know the truth to that too, don't we? But he was the Word, and he was the Word, and he was that Word. That's it. Believe God. God is the Word. Believe it. As Brother Branham said, I believe a Holy Ghost-filled believer will always believe the word. Now listen carefully. A Holy Ghost filled believer says, I will always believe the word. You see how cunning this can be, and people get confused. I always believe the word. Yes, sir. I believe the word, brother. Now let me say this. It takes more than just saying, I believe the word. Because everybody in every church says, I believe the word. The devils believe the word also. The Bible says so, and they tremble. Sure they do. They're afraid of it. It takes obedience of the word. The evidence you have the Holy Ghost is not just saying, I believe it, but you do it. We don't want to be hearers only, but doers of the word. Jesus said, don't be hearers only, but doers of the word. That's the evidence, or a evidence, that God is moving in your life. It takes obedience to walk in the light. Brother Bram says here, oh, apply it, church. Don't fail. Will you not? Don't let the sun set. Don't rest day or night. Don't take no chance. It won't work, children. It won't work. You must have the token. That is the Holy Spirit. That's what he's preaching on. The baptism of the Holy Ghost is the token. You must have the token. You say, I believe, yes, I believe the message. He said, that's all right, but, and that's good, but you must have the token. Do you hear me, Branham Tabernacle? You must have the token on display for everyone to see. Without it, all your believing is in vain. See, you say, I live a very good life. You listen to what the word says. You go to church. You try to live right. That's fine. But that's not it. You know what he's saying? You can have all that. People say, I believe. You believe? Yes. You believe? Yes. But it's more than that. Don't just come this far. Say, I believe the message. You obey the message. Come into Christ. You say, I believe every word you said, Brother Brennan. That's good. But that's just being able to read. Take the message. Take it into your heart that you must have the token, the very life that was in Christ to be in you. That's it. That's the token. Is to have the very life that was in Christ living in you. Who wants him to be living in you? I pray that we prayed last week where people received the Holy Spirit, people came forward, and that was really wonderful. Maybe there's some here that would like to be prayed for that weren't here. You're welcome to. So we do not look at evidences. You'll only be disillusioned and confused because unless you have a gift of discernment, you don't know the difference. I know what I'm talking about. Thinking, look, oh man, they look so spiritual. Oh, praise the Lord. I remember my dad had a very keen sense of discernment, discerning of spirits. People say, oh, Brother Searle, that person's wonderful. Praise God. He'd just stand there saying, well, I pray so. But Brother Searle, don't you realize? I just got a question. Sure enough, weeks later, that person's gone. Operating the gift of the Spirit. They might be speaking in tongues. They might be prophesying. They say, oh, he must have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. In all of these cases, they may have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, but they may not. Now, that's Bible. So we don't want to go off signs, off impressions, off on evidences, which we call evidences. No, brothers and sisters, we cannot do that. We've got to go off what God's word says. And Jesus gave some very clear examples of this very fact. We find this in Matthew 7, verse 21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And they did. And then I will profess unto them, I never knew you, Jesus said, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. So we cannot judge by the gifts we have. We cannot judge by the way God can even use people. He used Pharaoh of Egypt. The Bible says, I have raised up Pharaoh to reveal my glory. God said, I have raised up Pharaoh to reveal my glory. And he did. But he wasn't of God. But God used him just the same. God can do what he likes. Who believes God can do what he likes? You see, brothers and sisters, so we can't judge on what we see, what we feel, impressions we get. We're talking about receiving the Heavenly Father into our life. And just do what he says and believe what he says. There's no question these people were used with the gifts. There's so many people in the Pentecostal realms, I'm talking about the Pentecostal organizations today, get so carried away with all the gifts and, oh, this must be of God. It may be, it may not be. Some of it is, some of it isn't. But they never receive, they're never filled with the Spirit. I'll tell you why. They're anointed ones at the end time. The Bible says there'll be anointed ones at the end time. They are anointed of the Spirit of God, but in their heart they're not committed to God. They're not actually given over to God. The Lord wants all of you, brother and sister. He doesn't want 99% of you. He wants 100% of you. And that puts you into a new bracket of being a bride member of Christ. When you are 100% given over to God, and he fills you with his Spirit, then you are his sealed child of God. Now the Bible says in Matthew 5:45, talking about anointed ones, he says that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. Sister, I didn't give you the verse, did I? I'm sorry. Matthew 5:45. That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he, that's God, maketh his Son, his blessing, to rise on the evil and on the good. He sendeth rain, the anointing, on the just and the unjust. That's the Bible. So anointings, is this a big subject? It's really hard to skim over it. But people get carried away with anointings because they're anointed, they are definitely a child of God. Well, they may be, but they may not be. Because he said the rain falls on the just and the unjust. Now, when the rain comes over Gisborne, and it starts raining in the whole district, there could be a whole paddock of thistles, and the thistles are getting the water, and they are saying, praise the Lord, they're getting the blessings of God, just like the wheat on the next paddock. It's in the next paddock. The wheat is saying, praise the Lord, too. The same rain falls on the just and the unjust. And that's how it is in the spiritual realm. Jesus Christ said so. If you want to argue with that, you go and see him. But that's what he said. So maybe we come to the point, the evidence is, if we have a great revelation of the Scriptures, may we can understand all the mysteries of the kingdom of God, all that God has revealed in this day. If we understand that, maybe then that's an evidence we have the Holy Ghost. It's a evidence, but it's not the evidence. There's a difference between A and the. School teachers, big difference. Between A evidence and the evidence, totally different meaning. Great, isn't it? How God has arranged that. So if they think, well, I've got a great revelation. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 and 2. This is Bible. This is not Howard Sell. This is Bible. though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels. So here you have an angelic tongue from the Holy Spirit. And have not charity, that's love, I become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal, shallowness. And though I have the gift of prophecy, you can prophesy, and understand all mysteries, not some of them, all mysteries, and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, and have not charity, have not love, which is God Himself, the Holy Spirit, I am nothing. That is really a revelation, if there ever is. And it's not for me to judge anybody, but that's what he said. See, God is love. It's not God loves. It's more than God loves. He is love. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 16, for we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. There's your Holy Spirit. If you've got the true love of God, it's the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is love, God's love. It dwells in you. Dwelleth in love, dwelleth in God, and God in him. So there it is. It's all through the scriptures. So we don't want any false things in the church. We don't want any false things in our life. We want it to be genuine, pure, clean. Not just a little sensation or feeling or impression. It's got to be real, and you'll know it's God. And you know you're his child. And you know he's your heavenly Father. Hallelujah. Who's glad to be a child of God? And he will complete the work. He started in you, and he's going to finish the work. So, we also have love for our brothers and sisters is another evidence, not the evidence, but it's another evidence. If we have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, is to have a love one for another. Jesus said in John 13, verse 35, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, when you have the revelation of the seven seals. Doesn't say that. When you have a great revelation of the Word of God, doesn't say that. This is how all men out there will know that you are a child of God, that you are a disciple of the Lord, is when you have love one to another. Why? Because he is love. And if he's in you, you can't help loving one another. Who loves one another? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's so wonderful, isn't it? It's pure. It's a pure word. Some believe love and the fruits of the Spirit is an evidence. No, it's not. It's a evidence. It doesn't mean it is the evidence. There's a big difference. But there are different types of love too. It's a major subject, but I'm just skimming the top. Human love is one thing, and it can be pretty nice. Be really nice to people, and you meet people that are always kind and sweet and always helpful. Man, I'd like to be like that person. And they don't even know the Lord. It's a human love. And there's a godly love too. That can come in. People come to church that are really nice, and you know, like the kind old priest, he's kind to everybody. He looks really good, but it doesn't always turn out to be as it ought to be. I want to read you something. Brother Branham made a statement. He said, is there any here that hasn't received the baptism of the Holy Ghost yet? Now you say, Brother Branham, I tell you, I shouted one time. That's very good, he says. I spoke in tongues once. He said, that's very good too. But still, that isn't what I'm talking about. Now you can shout and speak in tongues. He says, now is a question actually. Now can you shout and speak in tongues and deny the word of God? No. The evidence of the Holy Ghost is believing his word. Always been, every age, if you can receive the word. He said those priests back in his day had Jesus beat a million times when it came to the fruits of the Spirit. They were gentle, they were peaceful, meek and lowly, he said. And he tore up the churches and he kicked them over and tore the people out, called them snakes in the grass. So if you want to measure the outward manifestations, it looked like the priests were really sweet going around, you know. Can I help you? And Jesus was plaiting ropes and beating the money changers, kicking over their tables. You've made my house a den of thieves. Didn't look like it. And he had the spirit, and the high priest looked like they had the love. And maybe he didn't because outward manifestations. But we know the truth to that too, don't we? But he was the word, and he was the word, and he was that word. That's it. Believe God. God is the word. Believe it. As Brother Branham said, I believe a Holy Ghost-filled believer will always believe the word. Now listen carefully. A Holy Ghost-filled believer says, I will always believe the word. You see how cunning this can be, and people get confused. I always believe the word. Yes, sir. I believe the word, brother. But let me say this. It takes more than just saying, I believe the word. Because everybody in every church says, I believe the word. The devils believe the word also. The Bible says so, and they tremble. Sure they do. They're afraid of it. It takes obedience of the word. The evidence you have the Holy Ghost is not just saying, I believe it, but you do it. We don't want to be hearers only, but doers of the word. Jesus said, don't be hearers only, but doers of the word. That's the evidence, or a evidence, that God is moving in your life. It takes obedience to walk in the light. Brother Bram says here, oh, apply it, church. Don't fail. Will you not? Don't let the sun set. Don't rest day or night. Don't take no chance. It won't work, children. It won't work. You must have the token. That is the Holy Spirit. That's what he's preaching on. The baptism of the Holy Ghost is the token. You must have the token. You say, I believe, yes, I believe the message. He said, that's all right, but, and that's good, but you must have the token. Do you hear me, Branham Tabernacle? You must have the token on display for everyone to see. Without it, all your believing is in vain. See, you say, I live a very good life. You listen to what the word says. You go to church. You try to live right. That's fine. But that's not it. You know what he's saying? You can have all that. People say, I believe. You believe? Yes. You believe? Yes. But it's more than that. Don't just come this far. Say, I believe the message. You obey the message. Come into Christ. You say, I believe every word you said, Brother Brennan. That's good. But that's just being able to read. Take the message. Take it into your heart that you must have the token, the very life that was in Christ to be in you. That's it. That's the token, is to have the very life that was in Christ living in you. Who wants him to be living in you? I pray that we prayed last week, where Peter received the Holy Spirit, people came forward, and that was really wonderful. Maybe there's some here would like to be prayed for that weren't here. You're welcome to. So we do not look at evidences. You'll only be disillusioned and confused. Because you, unless you have a gift of discernment, you don't know the difference. I know what I'm talking about. Thinking, look, oh man, they look so spiritual. Oh, praise the Lord. I remember my dad had a very keen sense of discernment. Discerning of spirits. People say, oh, Brother Searle, that person's wonderful. Praise God. He'd just stand there saying, well, I pray so. But Brother Searle, don't you realize? I just got a question. Sure enough, weeks later, that person's gone. It wasn't God. It looked like it. Sounded like it. Outward evidences is no evidence. It's got, you got it. We're talking about you receiving the Holy Ghost. You want to know that you have it. It starts in here. It's in your heart. You know you belong to God. Even when you make mistakes, you know you still belong to him. Hallelujah. Even if you make mistakes, he's my Heavenly Father. And he loves us. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We want that life to be in us. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is a real supernatural experience. It's something that only you can have. You can't get it out of this church. You can't get it out of me. You can't get it out of anybody else. It's between you and God. You say, I met him last night. That was him. And he's here to stay. I'll never leave you alone. Praise be to God. So the baptism is a real experience in which the fruits follow. No man, no woman can come into the presence of God and be normal. It's impossible. If you come into the presence of God, you cannot be normal. It's because of his exceeding power and his exceeding love and his preciousness is so real. You cannot be normal when you come to the presence of God. When people come to the presence of God, you see tears running down. Sometimes they're laughing or whatever. However the Spirit affects them, it's because you're walking into the presence of Almighty God. Sometimes on a platform, when the people came up to Brother Branham, they came before him, and the angel of the Lord was standing there as he always came. And people sort of, you could see the expression on the film, you could see their face. He said, now that won't hurt you. That's the presence of his being. I want to say this, brother and sister, when you come into the presence of God, it's not chewing gum. It's not just being flippant. It's a presence that'll change your life. Something that you'll know that you met God. So wonderful. Who loves the Lord? So it's a real experience. Brother Branham said here, these are all in 64, by the way, you cannot receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost without having an experience when it happens. I've heard people say, I got the baptism of the Holy Ghost by, what's the word they use? I can't think of it. When they say, I received it by, you know what I'm saying? Oh, June, you meant to help me. I just can't recall it. You know, it may come to me later. But he says, when you have received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, it actually is an experience when it happens. Now, if you believe every speck of the word, you say you believe every speck of it, then the word is laying there waiting for the Holy Ghost to put it to work. So you believe the word, that's good, but it needs the Holy Ghost to come to you. To put it to work, but it takes the lighting of the candle. The lighting of the candle, you can have a nice pretty candle, have wicks and wax and everything, but it's no use until it's lit. When it's lit, it gives life to the household. So we do not look at evidences. You'll only be disillusioned. What should we be looking at? We should be looking at Christ. Amen. Looking at Him to come into our hearts. He's a person. He's a wonderful person. He'll take you just as you are. You don't have to be super spiritual. You don't have to get into this sort of mold or that sort of mold. If you want Him to come into you, He'll come to you just as you are. As we sing that song, just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. Brother and sister, we're coming just as we are. You say, I need to be cleaned up. He'll clean you up. You need the Lord to clean you up. He's good at cleaning us up. The experience is based upon the love of God and His Word. Your relationship with Jesus Christ is a love relationship of what He did for you. He gave His life for you. He laid His life down for you. He died a most cruel death. And He suffered great agony and great pain for you. And we walk over the top of Him, trample over God. You'll pay for that one day. You come and say, Lord, I'm sorry for trampling over you, just going my own way. Lord, I want the Holy Spirit, and I want to walk right. If you want the Holy Ghost, you need to walk right. Don't fiddle with the world. Don't mix with that. Get away from those things that are holding you back. Say, Lord, I'm just going to go all the way with you. That pleases Him. Then He'll come and bless you. Hallelujah. God sends a message to the church. You'll hear it. To receive whom God has sent is an evidence that God has filled you. It's an evidence that God is speaking to you. We receive whom God has sent. You receive one another, and you have respect for one another. You respect one another. That's an evidence of the Holy Spirit. Your life without you knowing it will have a sweetness around you. Isn't that wonderful? A sweetness. It's really pure. You don't look now. What am I meant to do when I meet a brother? I've got to do it. No. When you've got the Holy Spirit, it's sweet. It's just so precious. Who wants it? Oh, it makes you sweet and soft and gentle. You're not critical of people. If you see somebody make a mistake, you just pray for them, knowing that you can make the same mistakes yourself. We love one another and respect one another. Your life, without knowing, will just reflect the sweetness of Christ. People ask me, how do I get the Holy Ghost? And I put it in simple words when I haven't got time to preach to them. I say, fall in love with Jesus Christ. If you love me, He said, you'll keep my commandments. You'll do what my word has said. If I say, don't want you to do that, don't do it. If you really love Him, you'll do it. And if you make a mistake, He'll correct you. And He can correct you back quite severely, Brother Bill. Brother Timmer was. You bring a correction. Sometimes a trial will correct you. He knows how to correct you. God knows how to bring a correction in your life. He knows all about you. He knows where to put His finger, and He knows just how hard to press to help you. As we close, we need to fall in love, to walk in light of His word, and that means to obey it. And God will do the rest. If He started this work, He's going to finish it. He's going to finish every job. And He's going to finish me too. I believe He will. He knows how much I love Him. He wants the Holy Spirit. Amen. Shall we stand for prayer? Lord Jesus, we bow our heads to You, and knowing that You're here, in this building, Lord. And we pray that you'll bless us, Lord, and bless everyone that's listening out on the internet. Wherever they are, Lord, they need the Holy Spirit too, Lord. They need this experience. And Lord, we realize that many variables, Lord, that come. Lord, I just pray that we won't get caught up with evidences or outward manifestations, Lord, but we will be dead sincere. Come as we are to you, Lord. And Lord, that you'd do a mighty work in our lives. I pray, Lord Jesus, that people will know that you have come into their life. They'll know that there's been a change, transformation. I just pray, Lord, that you'd bless each one here, Lord, as they come to thee, that you'll grant them the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Lord, it's so important that they receive this baptism because it's going to rapture us out of here. Lord, it's going to change our bodies. I pray, Lord, that we'll walk closer to thee this day in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, brother and sister, I know God's been here this morning. I know it. I know He. I know it. My heart's been spoken to. And I cannot do any more than that, but I'm just saying, I know He's speaking to hearts. And you really need a genuine experience of God. Hallelujah, Lord. He's here. Don't play with God. Time's running out. If you know that you need to be filled with the Spirit of God, you say, Lord Jesus, I just cannot go another mile without you. I need to be filled with the Spirit. Why don't you come to Him and say, Lord, fill me now, Lord. Just as I am, as the song says, just as I am, that one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. He'll forgive you if you're sincere and you're honest before Him. He will give you the Holy Ghost. He's longing to give you the Holy Ghost. So we're going to sing this beautiful hymn. And then if anybody would like prayer, you want to come forward, I'll pray for you, that God will fill you. He's here. Yes. Just as I am. Here in this church, and he put out his hands like that and said, if anyone thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He promised to give you an infilling of the Holy Spirit. He put his arms out like that, like this. And I want to tell you something. He is here. Right now. You can't see him, but he is here. With two or three gathered in my name, he said, there am I in the midst of you. The Holy Spirit's calling. You know that you must get closer to God. This is an opportunity that cannot be missed. It may be your last. I don't know. But He's here giving you that invitation that you'll know that you've received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You'll know it. Not, oh, I wonder if and all these. No, you'll know it. Just as I
just as I am, oh, to the truth.
raise your hands and we pray and sing too. You enter in. You know, Al Roberts used to say, put your hand on the radio as a point of contact. And many people receive their healing. And God is speaking to you. Don't let this moment pass. If you feel that calling in your heart, you need this experience. You just raise your hand and say, Lord, let it be me. And I want to hear testimony that God came down where you were. Hallelujah. Just as I am. Service will be replayed on Judgment Day. And you'll see the Spirit of God here. You'll know that God's here and what you did with what He was bidding you to do. Brother and sister, I'm not trying to persuade anybody, God forbid, but I want to let you know that it's very real what's happening right now. If you make light of it, that'll be to your own peril. But if you're sincere, God will bless you and help you. That's all I need to say. The rest is in the hands of God. Just as I am.
For a while there, reaching out for the Lord. But you know what? You know the Lord's going to come again, do you not? Is that true? People on the internet, Do you know the Lord's coming again for you? And while I was sitting there, I just think about an example, and you're looking at it right now, not me, but above me, out that top window, there's some trees there. The Lord made you, and He made those trees there as well. There's about 7 or 8 of them there, not a leaf on them. Bare as bare. But you know, it's God's creation as you are. But He's supplying what those trees need and want right now. But what are they doing? They're standing there still, receiving water that the Lord supplied, receiving the sunshine that the Lord supplied, and He will see them through. And those trees know that they're going to have leaves on, that they're going to be robust and beautiful, as you are. They know that the Lord will do it, the same as He does for us. They're not stressing. They're not getting all panicky about it. They're just sitting back and saying, Lord, I love you. And they're going to be beautiful, beautiful trees in a few months. They know it. We know it. God's doing it. And that's the same applies to us. And you people on the internet, you may or may not see those trees where you are. But He knows the same for you people as well. He loves you. And He will see us through. Well, I'm just going to close in prayer, ask the Lord to bless our luncheon and our fellowship, and to prepare for our service this afternoon. Just bow our heads in prayer. Lord Jesus, we know that You're so real, so true, and what You said You will do. You are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Almighty God, the one and only Creator. And You know us, Lord, so well that You know what we're thinking about right now. There's nothing that You don't know. You know our past, You know our present, and You know our future. And You have it all in control. Bless all of those, Lord, that have been listening to the truth that's been spoken this morning. We know it's true. Why do we know that? Well, the definition of it is in my heart for me. I know it's true, but I can only say it for me. And for those that want to receive the Lord Jesus Christ, may they know that it's true for them. Lord, we thank You for that word. We thank You for the word of God. Just bless our luncheon today, Lord, and bless us as we consider the things this afternoon service. We ask these things in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. You are dismissed.
Dismissed.